Hello and welcome to Inside the Women of Denver, where leaders share their successes, failures, and lessons learned on the journey to success. I'm Crystal Covington and I'm here with Katie Fowler, a creative life coach who facilitates momentum for those struggling on the path to find their creativity. Katie is the author of An Artist's Journey Through Wonderland, a story written to help people discover and overcome creativity crushers like procrastination and perfectionism. Katie, I can't wait to learn more about your unique talents. Thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you for having me. I'm thrilled to be here.
Yes. So we're going to make this a therapy session for Crystal today.
Okay.
So I had some creativity crushers in my life that I want to share with you. I actually thought early on that being creative, so let me start off. I used to be an artist as a kid. I actually sold art back when I was in, I think it was middle school. Somebody from a corporation bought one of my art pieces and I made $50.
Wow.
That was my first sale of art. And I remember being very inspired by it, always having straight A's in art class and doing really well there. But then at some point, I don't know where the messages came, but I started to believe that art is not something I should pay attention to and I should start paying attention to math and science primarily. And so I quit doodling, I quit doing my art programs, I didn't do any more art shows, and that was that. It went kaput, and I started studying psychology and, you know, math and science. I did science fairs and things like that, so went a whole nother direction. I know that's a really great thing. People love women in STEM and women studying that, but what would you say, I mean, what causes people to start pushing art away and believing that that's not something that we should do? We put it away, we don't touch it again.
Well, I have a one-word answer for that. Mm-hmm. I believe it's fear.
Okay.
And fear is hidden in a million different ways in our society, but creativity is difficult.
Yeah.
It's an endeavor that requires us to be vulnerable. It requires us to put ourselves out there. The creativity crushers, I've named them. There are five of them. So the first one is Dobie Doubter. And Dobie's a pretty nice guy. He's a hard one to get past because his intentions are good. Ooh, are you sure you want to use those bright colors?
Oh.
Ooh, are you sure you want to write that book? Oh, I bet someone else has already written a book about creativity. So Dobie's a tough one. Then there's the bully mean girl, and she tells you you're not good enough. Kind of with attitude, you're not good enough. And then there's the poser dozer, who just bulldozes you over and says you really don't know what you're talking about and someone's gonna find out, or you really don't know what you're doing. I just have to think. I have to gather my thoughts for a minute. And then there's the fluke flinger, and this is the one that comes up for me the most. This is the one who takes our past successes and uses them against us. That's great that you sold that piece of art in middle school for $50. I bet you can't make anything that good again.
Ooh.
Bet you're one and done. Or you're a one-show pony.
Yeah.
So the fluke flinger's a tough one. And then the final one is the evil dictator. And I'm not sure everybody has an evil dictator. But if you do, you probably know it. And this is the one who says you aren't enough.
Yeah.
And so what we have to do with those is look at them, acknowledge them, and then, like the Cheshire Cat, just grin at them.
Yeah.
They hate to be laughed at. And they're not real. So I think that's why creativity or artistic pursuits are so difficult for people.
Yeah, I think I struggle with, what was the one that the mastermind behind you that says you're not good enough?
That's the bully mean girl.
Yeah,
and
I have a bully mean girl.
Yeah, she does.
Yeah, she whips her hair.
Kind of valley girl, and she has a posse too.
Yeah, she's got a huge posse.
She does
in my
head. Which I'm trying to learn how to do. There you go. Okay.
I think that was more my generation, the snap.
Right.
Three steps.
I can't do it.
Definitely. So those are things that really hold people back. I can definitely see how valuable it is to understand what those are, but what are the things that people can do to try to battle and fight those off, because they're very strong?
Well, they are strong and they're real.
Yeah.
And I'd like to go off the path just a tiny bit here if I could, and say that I believe we're all creative, that's part of my overarching message.
Yeah.
I can't tell you how many, when I say I'm a creative life coach, so many people say to me, oh, I don't have a creative bone in my body.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we're all creative. It's in our human nature. So I wanted to answer your question with that thought in mind. Do you remember what the question was?
The question was, how can people battle those negative crushers,
right.
The crushers?
Okay. So, in order to deal with anything in life, we have to know what it is.
Yeah.
So I think of it like a monster under the bed. Those creativity crushers feel like monsters under the bed, but if we lift the dust ruffle, we can see that they're just dust bunnies, and they're not real.
Yeah.
They stem from comparison, competition. They're not real.
Yeah. I remember reading a study that said that most people, when they're children, if you ask them if they're artistic or creative, they will say yes. If you ask adults, most people will say no. And something happens in between there that challenges us and changes us, and it's all those, I keep forgetting the name, the crushers that you talked about that definitely are holding us back as adults. What are some of the things that you do to keep that creativity in your life and the artistic bones in your body?
Well, I love that you brought up children. And one of the things that happens for kids, the reason older kids and adults aren't comfortable saying that they're artistic, mm-hmm. is because, it has to do with human development.
Yeah.
Children don't compare what they're doing with what they have in their head. They're involved in the process.
Uh-huh.
As adults, when we set out on a creative endeavor, we often have an idea of what we want it to be like in our head. And there aren't really very many people in the world who are able to execute something artistically to match the idea in their head. Successful artists are in the moment. Mm-hmm. And if you talk to successful artists, they embrace the process.
Yeah.
And they are able to detach themselves from the outcome.
Okay, that is huge. That is definitely the big one, is detaching yourself from the outcome in life in general. I feel like one of the biggest reasons for our unhappiness, the reason why we feel discomfort in life, is because we're comparing to what we think we should be or where we think we should be at, and the unhappiness is seeing where we are today compared to what we have in our head. I can say I'm guilty of that all the time.
I want to jump up and down.
Yeah.
That's exactly right. And there are so many wonderful things with technology in our world, but I find that things like social media, ads on television, we're constantly hearing, if you're fit enough, if you're thin enough, yeah. if you're pretty enough, if your hair's the right color, then you can find happiness. And the problem with that, in my opinion, is we go through life comparing our inside feelings with other people's best presentations
yes.
of themselves.
Big lesson right there.
So I look on Facebook and, you know, whatever I see that's going on. The ones I love are the alcohol commercials on television. If you drink, you know, whatever it is, then you're going to have a million friends and drive around
oh,
in
yeah.
a house on a trailer. It's that message that we're not quite doing it right. And if we were, we would have these full, beautiful, cool lives.
Mm-hmm.
And my message is, you're doing it just right.
Yeah.
So we have to know what we love. We have to know what stops us, because otherwise, if I don't recognize that the bully mean girl's in the back of my head telling me I don't have the skills to do this or I'm not good enough, I can't do anything about it. If I have that niggling doubt, then, and what I do, and this is kind of silly, but I physically turn and say, that's not true. I'm good enough.
All right, well, that makes sense to put it into, basically give that thing that's trying to hold you back a physical presence and talk to them. And, you know, kind of push them away, push them aside like a real human being.
Well, if we're, it, and it's all from us, it's all internal, but if we're gonna give it the power to stop us, then we need to take the power back to say, you're not stopping me.
Yeah.
So that's what I do.
Powerful. So what are some of the things that you just love doing as a part of the work that you do?
Well, I'm a little older to change careers. I've been a studio artist for about 20 years, and I was a school teacher before that. And I feel like what I want to do is help. I'm a helper. So I feel like my message is important, and I just heard someone talk about our unique story.
Yeah.
So I hope to help people. What I love doing is when people see their unique value and are able to embrace that. That's what I hope to do in my coaching practice.
Yeah.
And lots of questions. I ask lots of questions because I believe we all have the answers. They're there. We just don't know which questions to ask ourselves to find the answers.
That is so very powerful. So tell me about, I want to talk creativity. Have you ever had a creative failure?
And have you ever?
No. When was one notable creative failure?
Never, huh? I don't know what that's all about. Well, so I'd like to go way back to the day of big hair and Varnays when I was in college. I was an art major, fine art major. In my second drawing class, the teaching assistant, and now when I tell this story now, keep in mind that the teaching assistant was probably the same age as my son is now. And he was looking through my portfolio, and he said, you know, you're a wonderful copier, but the world has Xerox machines for that.
Oh, wow.
And in retrospect, there are so many powerful lessons there. The first one is, he was probably just trying to push me a little bit.
Yeah.
The second one is, my reaction to it was all my responsibility. I do not hold him accountable. I changed majors.
Oh, wow.
I was mortified.
Yeah.
The evil dictator. You're not enough to be an art major. So I changed to art education, loved learning theory, changed to elementary education, and I had a lovely career as a school teacher and a staff developer. So I take full responsibility for letting that message crush me.
Yes.
However, I'm so grateful to that young man, who's not probably that young anymore, but because I know what it feels like to really feel that devastation about something that you've worked hard on.
Yeah.
And that's a difficult thing to get past. It really is, it's tough. I was working with a client last week and she'd gone to a critique group. And the woman said, well, this really seems more like craft to me than art.
Oh.
So sometimes we experience, you know, the ton of bricks
yeah.
type of put down, and sometimes we create them ourselves. But what happens in the creative process, the part of the brain, and I don't know a lot about this, I know enough about it to talk about it just a little bit.
Yeah.
Our cerebral cortex is the creative part of our brain. Our amygdala is the part that controls our emotions. The amygdala is the guy who says fight or flight. And he's not very smart.
Okay, yes.
So
our lizard brain. I know that part. Yes, the lizard brain.
Exactly. So our lizard yes. brain doesn't know. When our lizard brain gets fired, it shuts the cerebral cortex down. Now, probably the evolutionary reason for this is we don't want to be looking at a saber-toothed tiger and thinking, huh, I wonder if I could tame that. Look at that beautiful fur. We
yeah,
need to get out
there.
You don't
need it at that time.
Right.
So basically, stress kills creativity.
Exactly.
Oh, my goodness.
Yep. And what a lot of us end up doing, I call them silicone clubs. We're like cavemen. Yeah. So we have that niggling of fear, but the amygdala doesn't know if it's a saber-toothed tiger or Dobie Doubter and reacts the same way. And that's why people would rather clean their washing machine than do what feeds their soul.
Oh.
And that's tragic to me.
Yeah.
And it's quite a common occurrence. I like to say there have been miles of self-help books written about the creative process. Miles meaning they could fill up miles of bookshelves because it's difficult.
Mm-hmm.
And because the creative process puts us in such a vulnerable position, it feels like a personal attack when
yes.
we're not successful.
Oh my gosh, that is so, that just hit it, you know, right there is that vulnerability piece. Most people, I mean, realistically, I mean, almost no one is comfortable with really being vulnerable. Being vulnerable is tough, it's
right.
scary, it's stressful, and it's easy to just say, you know what, I don't want to feel that, I'm just going to walk away.
Right. Unfortunately, we miss out on a lot because
yeah.
it's that vulnerability that connects us with the world. And for me, creativity is about connection. It's about connection to ourselves, to others, and to a higher creativity. And if I don't allow myself that vulnerability, then I miss out on all of that. So, what do you do?
Mm-hmm.
What's the solution?
What is it?
We've sort of beat the problem. The solution is to immerse yourself in the process.
Okay.
In my opinion. In my coaching practice, I say there are no to-do lists, only to-da lists. My coaching training was highly influenced by a man named Bob Maurer, who talks about tiny little steps.
Uh-huh.
So I worked with a woman once who could not touch her paints. She had not painted in years.
Wow.
And she was having a terrible time. This was one of my first clients. And I suggested she just go, she didn't have a studio, so just go to the closet where your supplies are and take out a paintbrush and rub the bristles on your hands, remember what it feels like, maybe open one tube of paint and smell it. Mm-hmm. And then that's all you're gonna do.
Wow.
That's it for today. So what that does is it gets our brains going and allows us, our human brains will work on ideas, questions, subconsciously. So you open that tube of paint and subconsciously those wonderful memories come flowing back.
But you don't do anything with it yet.
Well, you might be moved to do something
uh-huh.
with it. But, you know, I've also, during my training, I heard a woman say, so I lost my creativity and I'm going to make a painting a day for a year.
Did she do it?
Well, no,
oh.
because that's kind of a big...
That's a big deal.
That's a big deal. That's a...
a painting every day. That's
a lot
yeah.
to put on your plate. So don't put a lot on your plate. If you can't get started, take a tiny little step. What would it feel like to feel 5% more excited about what you're doing? Mm-hmm. What would it feel like to give yourself 5% more permission to enjoy yourself?
Yeah. I love that. Yeah, I bought my father, he was dealing with some creative blocks. He's been, we have paintings all over our house from my dad. He brags about having won art shows and awards and won money and having given away paintings to people. I've watched him paint clay statues and paint paintings over the years. We used to do things together. Mm-hmm. And at some point he stopped. And it was probably a lot of stress and anxiety over the time of his life, but as an older adult now, he doesn't work, the kids have left the house, and he wants to paint. He bought painting supplies, but they just sit there. So I bought him some adult coloring books, and I figured it would be a baby step. I thought he might think it was really dumb. He actually picked them up. It took him a little while. He picked them up. He says, okay, well, I have nothing to do. Let me try this. He has gone wild. I have bought him every one of them now. He has almost everything they've created. And he just goes at it, and it's really bringing up something for him. He still hasn't gotten to the paintbrush yet, but he feels like he can get more and more. He's making baby steps towards picking up that paintbrush eventually. But at least he's working his creativity and getting excited about putting colors on paper again.
That's a wonderful thing to do. Yeah. And I'm so glad you brought up the coloring book, because people want to make my message color outside the lines.
Ah.
And it's not.
Okay.
That's not my message. If you love coloring inside the lines, then you embrace that and you go in whole hog. You go all in with that. My favorite example of that is my husband is a competitive golfer.
Whoa.
And we are totally opposite. But we've known each other since seventh grade, so it seems to work. But that's his creative outlet. Now, golf is a game that's filled with rules. Mm-hmm. You have to be fast. You have to use the right club. You have to, you know, it's filled with... There's a whole book about the rules of golf.
Wow.
But that's his creative outlet. Uh-huh. He loves that. So it's not that we have to create something new. The psychologist Mihai Csikszentmihalyi calls it flow, and that's optimal experience. That's when we need to find whatever it is that makes time pass without knowing that time passes.
Oh, that's so amazing.
And it isn't... I'm not an advocate that everybody needs to be a painter, mm-hmm. or have something hanging in a gallery or write a book. Yeah. I'm an advocate that you know what fires your engines, you go all in with that, you grow through that process, and then you find that flow.
Yeah, I love that.
So if it's coloring inside the lines, you color inside the lines.
As long as you're in flow.
That's right.
Beautiful. Well, this was an amazing conversation. I feel like you have just, I was sitting here leaning in the whole time, like, oh, what is this? Tell me more, because I want to get into something. I want to get back into my creativity. I mean, this is my creativity right now. I've just evolved from the paintbrush to the video and you know, the entertainment space, creating content.
Well, you are, in my opinion, you're following your heart.
Yeah.
And that's a tough thing for people to do. I have written on a scrap of paper pinned above my desk, why is it that I cannot commit to that which feeds my soul? Mm-hmm. And I think, especially for women, who primarily that's who I work with, so I can't speak for men, but we don't think we deserve it.
Yeah.
A lot of times. So whatever that is, that's, it's feeding your soul right now.
It is.
And people can see that. Because you're good at it, you're passionate about it. It's what, it's you, it's authentic. So that's what you do.
Well, that is a lovely end to my counseling session today. Thank you. This has been a lovely session.
I'll send you a bill.
Okay, I hope it's not too much. Oh my God, those bills keep racking up.
Yeah, right?
Well, thank you so much. Is there any last words that you want to share with the audience before we leave?
You know, yes, and I'll be brief, and they aren't my words.
Okay.
Be you, because everyone else is already taken.
Ooh.
And Dolly Parton said, know who you are. Oh, now I'm not going to be able to remember what she said. Mm-hmm. Something, though, to the effect that find out who you are and just embrace it. Yeah. Be that, because it attracts goodness.
I love that. Well, thank you so much. And thank you for spending time with us on Inside the Women of Denver. You spent time with me, Crystal Covington, and Miss Katie Fowler. Please get in touch with us as much as you want to. We love to have conversations. And I just want you to remember, I'm so taken, I can't even close. I just want you to always remember that you deserve to be seen, heard, and known. We'll see you again soon.